Welcome, everyone, to our Wednesday evening discussion of the book Growing Young, which is part of our Growing Together emphasis that we're doing together as a church. Today, we'll talk about the chapter entitled Fueling Warm Community, or Fuel Warm Community, about how significant and important that is as we seek not only to connect with and minister to and minister with teenagers and young adults ages 19 to 29, but with everybody. Devontae Edwards is away at Parchment Valley this week doing coursework for his Master of Divinity degree through Palmer Theological Seminary. So he sends his regards. Alicia and I will be leading the study today, tonight. Before we do so, an announcement and then several prayer requests. You'll see in the columns this week that John Brannon is getting our handbell choir started. And their first rehearsal will be after church in the sanctuary on Sunday, and it's open to anyone. Anyone who wants to learn handbells or be a part of handbells, it's open to families, all ages. Handbells is one of those things that we can do masked, socially distanced, and gloved, so it's the perfect first restart of a choir activity. And handbell veterans, obviously, we hope that you feel if you feel comfortable that you'll come and do it, but we're also opening up to anyone. So go ahead.
And I just want to add just a little plug in for anybody who has never been in a rehearsal with John Brannon. It is great fun. Not only is he immensely talented, but he's immensely humorous. If you've ever heard him on the radio, you'll know what a gift he has for humor. And he brings such a joy to his work. I loved it the times I was able to sing in choir and he was directing, because you workshop, you know your music, but it's so fun while you're learning. So I just wanted to put that plug in. This is a great opportunity. And he did again mention it'll be simple. We will be getting something ready for Easter, so we've got about 6 weeks to do that. And we'll be practicing again after church. It won't be long rehearsals, so
you'll
don't worry about that.
You'll still get to have lunch.
Yeah,
you'll and you'll still get to take a nap if you
Which is always a value for me.
If you want to. Right. So let us know if you have any questions about that. Let John know if you would like to be a part of it. Several prayer requests for us to be remembering. Stephen Lamb, who is a former member of our church, was living in Athens, Georgia with his daughter for many years, but he passed away this week, and his funeral service will be Saturday here at the church. The service will be at 1 o'clock, and then there will be a visitation preceding the service in the sanctuary from 11 to 1. So let's remember his family, and many of us who knew him, I'm sure will make efforts to be a part of the services this Saturday. Dee Harbor starts her cancer treatment tomorrow, so we want to pray for Dee and for Bud in this journey. And then let's continue to pray for Richard Finley's mother, who is at hospice, and pray for Richard and for their family during this time. Alicia, would you pray for us?
Well, brothers and sisters, let us pray. Everlasting God, we are grateful for the many ways you have worked already in our lives this week to bring us to this day, open and ready to learn together and to hear from you. We give you thanks for restored electricity for so many in our area, for the cleanup crews that are working hard. And we give you thanks for the sunshine today. After that severe winter weather, it is a joy to feel some warmer temperatures. And we are reminded, Lord, that whether in storm or sunshine, you are with us. And you have given us one another to walk this road. Lord, we lift to you those who are hurting. We pray for the family of Stephen Lamb in his death. We give you thanks for the impact he made while he was here with us. And we pray for his upcoming service, that it would be a true honoring of his life and a true worship of you. We pray for Richard Finley and his precious family as his mother is at hospice. May your hand be upon every detail. And we pray for Dee and Bud as Dee undergoes treatment beginning tomorrow. She has walked this road before, and Lord, we pray that you would hold them close as they go through this time, and that we could be a support to them and to all who need us in these days. We give you thanks, Lord, that we belong to you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Which, before we go into the book, your prayers for those without power and thanksgiving as we've gotten through the storm. Last week we couldn't have the Ash Wednesday service in person. We're grateful to all who were able to join us online, and to Katie for making that possible. We are in the season of Lent, and so this is that season of confession and reflection upon the suffering of Jesus. And even though we're doing the Wednesday night growing young, growing together emphasis, we're still mindful of the season that we're in. And certainly that's a part of our worship that shapes our worship on Sundays. So tonight we're on the chapter of fueling a warm community, but Alicia, you had some thoughts of tying that chapter with the earlier chapter on empathy. Would you start by talking about that?
I will. I also wanted to make a point about Lent, is that it seems to me that growing young, reading this book and reflecting on what it brings up for us, is actually a really good Lenten practice, because part of what we do in Lent is sort of take the temperature of our own spiritual lives and our life together as a church, and look at the places where we have much to celebrate and give thanks to God, offer a sacrifice of praise for those places, and also pay attention to the places that need some love and time and attention, which is part of repentance. It's part of making a turn and doing things differently, is taking that temperature and seeing where we need things to change. And part of growing young, it's a very positive approach. Growing together is truly what it's aimed towards, because churches that are growing young are growing, period, spiritually. It's not just about young people, it's about the whole church. Which brings us to the reflection today. I want to go back briefly to chapter 3, which talked about the second core commitment.
Empathize
with today's young people. And it talked a lot, it was really getting us into the mindset and the experience of today's young people, starting with teens and then going up to young adults up to age 29. And part of what they talked about is how in today's world there's an extended adolescence. It starts earlier, it starts even before middle school for many young people, and then it ends later, closer to age 29. So there's this more extended adolescence, and within that extended adolescence, there's a lot of pressure. Now, adolescence is always a time of change and growth. Young adulthood is a time of change and growth, and that's a challenge. At the same time, today's young people are under some pressures that I didn't experience, we didn't experience, and generations before us didn't experience either. Especially around technology, around having such a plethora of and a pressurized environment of lots of focus on different choices that they can make, and how they're supposed to have all the answers. They're supposed to have things figured out, which of course no one ever does have things totally figured out, but a lot of young adults feel like they should. So they have this constant pressure and just a pervasive sense of stress. And whereas in previous years, that started for a lot of later teenagers as they were turning towards college or careers, that sense of pressure, it actually is starting more now with middle schoolers. So kids that are 11 and 12 are starting to feel this very heavy impact. And it's something for us, we need to be aware of, because not only is this the future of the church, this is the church. These children and young adults are the church now, and we're called to be a body together, which we'll talk about a little bit more. Okay, the three ultimate questions in that that are a part of empathizing with today's young people, that every young person, and this kind of crosses space and time, but it's very intense now, ask the questions, who am I? Questions about identity. Where do I fit? Questions about belonging. And what difference do I make? Questions about purpose. And that chapter about empathizing really looks at how there's such more of an erratic search for identity today. There's an uncertain quest for belonging. It's very hard in many ways for today's young people to find that safe, secure space. And then also there's this meandering journey towards purpose. A lot of times we tell kids, like in middle school, they're supposed to know what they're going to be when they grow up. And so, or they play such intensive sports that, let's say, or dance, let's say you've done dance since you're 3 and you end up as a teenager having an injury and you can't do dance anymore, well, who are you? If so much of your life has revolved around that, same thing could go with, like, say, a baseball injury, you know, then who are you if you're not a baseball player? So much of your life is
around. And important to know that all of us still deal with those questions.
Absolutely.
There's just an intensity of it in those teenage and adolescent years, which means in terms of empathy, the more we can get in touch with how we actually deal with those questions, the better we're able to be present with and empathize with young adults and with students.
That's an excellent point.
Let me make one more point, that not to distract you from where you're going, but this was Eugene Peterson, who writes The Message, the translator of The Message. One of his first books years and years ago was a book about parents living with teenagers, walking with teenagers. And one of the observations that he made, so I'm speaking specifically now, if you have parents of young adults and teens, but one of the observations that he made is typically in the life cycle that we all go through, teenagers are going through the changes and challenges of adolescence around identity, belonging, and purpose at the same time that usually their parents are going through getting into middle age.
And are dealing with the same questions.
And are dealing with, okay, now at middle age, I'm recalibrating around identity, community, belonging, and purpose. Often that's because, you know, our parents are getting older. Perhaps we're caring for older parents. Perhaps we're having career changes, or, you know, all those kinds of things. So I've always found that to be a very helpful and grace-filled observation, that just as our teenagers are going through these issues of adolescence, a lot of their parents are doing the same thing as they enter into, or maybe they're fully into, those middle life challenges. So just wanted to make that observation. And the larger point is all of us deal with identity, belonging, purpose, and the more we can, as adults, can
lean into that,
the better we can walk with teenagers and young adults.
I would also add to Peterson's thing, not only are the parents of adolescents often going through this, but the grandparents are too. Because they are aging and often dealing with new medical issues, or and also retirement. Well, who am I if I'm not an accountant? Or who am I if I'm not a nurse? You know, again, I think that's an excellent point. All of these questions are sort of eternal life questions. But there is a specific intensity around adolescence with these, and especially today. So, wrapping up this part, wanted to just go back to that chapter, talk about those questions, and be able to say that there is a different intensity for today's young adults and youth, and that's something we have to be aware of as their brothers and sisters in Christ. And if we want them to continue to be a part of our church family, then they need some extra support and love and attention that maybe historically the church has not put in this age group. Sort of like, okay, once my kids are out of that age group, I don't have to deal with that age group anymore. Whereas this is a real shift to say, well, no, we are the body of Christ. We're the family of God, and we're all in this together. So this doesn't mean we pay attention to young people at the expense of anybody else, but it says we're going to intentionally focus on young people in such a way that we are helping to address this terrible stress and sense of confusion and struggle that they're going through. Okay, I do want to point this out, which is going to lead us into this chapter, which is in this desperate search for identity, belonging, and purpose. One of the things that young adults reported in the research that the Fuller Youth Institute was doing is that they, as a group, routinely mentioned a sense of adult abandonment. It sounds more dramatic, probably. Don't mean to say that their parents have abandoned them, but family stresses are such, economically, socially, often maritally, all of these pressures come in so that the family adults maybe aren't able to focus as much on their kids' needs.
And that was one of the things that actually came up in our small group discussion Sunday. So we've had these discussions online, but we had a small group Sunday for anybody who wanted to come and add their voices to the conversation, and that came up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, and again, the busyness that our adolescents and young adults right. are feeling, the parents are feeling it too. And so there may not be as much relational time as was in years past. And that's just the reality we're in. No shame in that, no complaining, no judging. It's just where we are.
Right.
So in addition to just feeling like sometimes in their families, they may not have as much of a sense of belonging there, but also other adults around them, neighbors, teachers, coaches, church people, Sunday school teachers, just adults in their lives who might have invested in years past, that often they feel abandoned by those people too. That it feels like those folks, that we are not paying as much attention to them either. And we're not, they have a hunger for caring adults in their lives. That's what the youth and young adults kept reporting to the Fuller Youth Institute. They are hungry for it. But what they're finding is the adults around them are not responding to that hunger very much. Out of their own busyness, out of their own struggles, right. out of just the culture shifts that we're all dealing with, but that lack of connection and that lack of a sense of belonging and that lack of adult focus, the adults around them aren't really paying attention, that is an Achilles heel for the future of the church, for the present of the church and the future of the church. Which brings us to this right. chapter 5, Fuel a Warm Community. That part of empathizing with young adults is realizing what they're longing for. And they are, as a group, longing for warmth and belonging.
One of the things that I think is really important for us to name, and the book names this and their research names this, is that we tend to think, I read this chapter to say that they're saying that warm community is like the baseline, it's the foundation.
Absolutely.
Of everything. Mm-hmm. I mean, the other, all of the six characteristics are important, but this one is like the, this is what you build on. And if you don't have this, if you don't have a sense of warmth in your community, then young people are gonna look for that warmth elsewhere. And tying that in theologically, if you don't have a sense of warmth in your community, in your church, then you're not being open to the Spirit of Jesus establishing the warmth of Jesus. So it's not about being nice, even though that can be important. It's about so loving Jesus and allowing Jesus to inhabit your church through the Spirit in your lives that there is a warmth. It's the warmth of Jesus that's given off. And I think that's what everybody craves, but especially young people. But one of the things that I really appreciated in this research is that there's a tendency to think that, well, if we're going to reach young people, if we're going to reach young adults, then we want to make sure that our programs and our worship and what we do is attractive to them or that it connects to them. And that is important, but what I love about the research is that one of the points they make, bad worship or bad preaching that doesn't connect with anybody or doesn't connect particularly with young people can push and probably will push young people away. But great contemporary worship or great preaching doesn't automatically draw them in.
And it definitely doesn't keep them there.
It doesn't keep them there. So it's not like you... So how we do things is important. But we could do everything perfectly in ways that might connect with young people programmatically or worship or whatever. But if there's not a sense of warmth, then...
It's empty.
It doesn't connect.
Right. So that was one of my favorite parts too.
Yeah.
Is because there's a lot of, I think when churches look around, congregations look around and they see not as many people, maybe under 30, right. around, they think, oh, we got to get the best programs. We got to cool up our worship. You know, our worship needs to be more cool. And we need to do this and this, or we just need flashier marketing. No. Yeah. That programming, it's not that it doesn't matter. Ministries, I don't like the word programming. Ministries matter, right. But the core of that ministry is warmth. The core of that is reflecting the love of Jesus Christ, which means that the youth and young adults can come to us as they are. Not, that's part of warm community, is knowing that they can come and they are not coming under judgment. I not long ago heard somebody talk about somebody, I was describing somebody, and they said, well, is that that person who looks dot 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 dot, and it was said with a bit of a judgmental edge, I'll just go ahead and say that. And that is exactly the opposite of what we're looking for. What we're looking for is a place where our youth and young adults can be accepted as they are, and we walk and journey in discipleship together.
And looking at page 164, I highlighted this, that for those churches where young adults and teenagers were sticking, where they had found a home, the authors say it wasn't the preaching or the teaching, it certainly wasn't the building or the worship style, it was the life shared among the congregation that drew them in. Again, I want to keep repeating this, it's not that preaching and teaching and worship don't matter, they do, and we want to be theological. We believe as preachers that preaching is absolutely central to what we do as the body of Christ, in that the Word of God, God speaks when we preach and God speaks in our worship. We're not saying that's not important, but we're saying that the styles of those, of how those things happen, you don't have to shape them to fit what young people want. You're faithful to who you are, and you have a warm community.
Right, and a great example would be, you can have fabulous preaching and amazing worship, and if somebody tells you when you sit down that you're sitting in their seat, doesn't matter. They're not coming back.
They're not sticking around.
So, I just want to get back to this. So, programs alone are not enough. Worship alone is not enough to connect and give that sense of belonging and that sense of warmth. So it's warmth. And the language used most often, they used several words that young adults and youth used: welcoming, accepting, belonging, authentic, hospitable, caring. But the biggest one was like family. We're like family here. That's what that kept coming along. So another point they made is too much programming, too many activities. I like that word better than programming. Activities actually pull away from warmth. That because everybody is so unnecessarily busy that there's not time to build connection and relationship.
And then I would say within those activities, this is on 166, they talk about the activities that create space for people to be together and to nurture relationships. So, so many of our activities do create that space and that opportunity for us to connect with each other. We need to take better advantage of that, I think. So we're very grateful that the power was on at the church, and that
during the last storm
when our family was without power for six days, and just how we use the building in kind of quick decisions that need to be made, the senior pastor and the property commission's chair consult with each other and make quick decisions. And so I talked with Pam Morrison, who is our property chair, and said, hey, what do you think about us using the building for families in the church, individuals in the church that are without power, that can come and stay, couch, sleeping bag,
shower,
and all that kind of stuff. And obviously, Pam immediately said, yes, let's do it. And so it was our family and several other, not whole families, but several individuals stayed, and then others came by that didn't stay but used the showers and all that kind of stuff.
Or laundry.
Laundry. Mm-hmm. But what occurred in that, which basically amounted to a six-day lock-in, what occurred was connection. There was space for all of us who were here. Some of us here all the time, others here parts of that time, to enjoy being together in a time of stress. I mean, it was a stressful time for everybody, but there was a warmth in the building that wasn't just because the power was on and the heat functions well. There was a relational warmth that took place. And so it's not that I'm not suggesting that we take a week or two a year and everybody lives at the church, but it is to say that when we're back together having meals in the fellowship hall. That we're not just trying to rush through, you know, sometimes you have to get through the meal quickly because you got to get to a meeting or something like that. But let's not, as a rule, let's not rush through those meals. Let's be intentional about where we sit with people that we don't know as well, and let's take that time to get to know each other and to fuel that warm community. We've seen that happen throughout the pandemic because our youth have been able to gather socially distanced in ways that adults haven't, and it's just been great to see the time that the youth have spent together, the ski trip, those kinds of things. And so those are not just fun activities, although they are fun, but they are crucial building blocks for fueling warm community. And you know, the picnic that we do in August that we didn't get to do this year, but that we'll hopefully do this year, last year. You know, all those things are opportunities.
Well, we did do the
we did the outside one.
We did the parking lot picnic.
The tailgate.
We did do that. We did do that, and goodness gracious, to see people after not being able to see each other, there was lots of warmth, and that was intergenerational too. That was because one thing I would say is like when churches are assessing, when we're assessing for ourselves, like, how warm are we as a congregation? You know, do you remember the cold game, hot game? You know, are you close to it? You're hot or you're cold. We may think of the people we know and maybe in our Sunday school class or the people in choir or whatever, we'll say, oh yeah, we're warm to each other. And that's wonderful. But what does it look like to expand that warmth, so it's not just in that group, but that warmth from that group then radiates out to youth and young adults, to other people, new people who come our way, that is key, so that warmth becomes not just who we're with most of the time, but it's part of our DNA, is what they talk about in the book, that warmth is part of your DNA. So I want to really get theological for a minute, which is that one of the things they talk about, and I love this, is the theology of church, what it means to be the church, is called ecclesiology. Ecclesia is the Greek word for church or congregation. And within that, we have a model from Scripture. We have really two models, the body of Christ and the family of God. And so both of those are intrinsically warm, if you think about it. The body of Christ, we are in relationship. We belong to one another. We are part of one body, and Jesus is the head of that body. And so we belong to the Trinity. We belong to Jesus, and we belong to one another, so that we're part of one another. And that is intrinsically a warm image, and it's not just an image, it's our identity.
Right. Yeah, and I think that's the image that we really want to focus on and embody. You know, the church functions on multiple levels. In one sense, we are an institution, so we have institutional responsibilities and structures that we have to have in order to have to pay the light bill, but in order to not have chaos.
Right.
You know, so we have to have the structures that any institution in society has, and yet we don't want to define ourselves by those structures. Biblically, we're defined by who we are as the family of God, as the body of Christ. And again, those are warm metaphors, warm images, theological richness. And you mentioned the warmth of Jesus through the Holy Spirit filling our church and then our interactions with each other.
Right. And so, again, sort of like they said earlier, that it's not that programs or activities don't matter. It's not that structure doesn't matter, because good structure empowers ministry and enables ministry. But that's the point. The ministry, being the body of Christ, being the family of God, is the center, and the structure helps make that happen. When we put too much emphasis on the structure or on the programs, we're missing the warmth. And people intrinsically know that when they come to us.
And so we want the warmth within the activities, but and sometimes we have to, you know, structure activities that kind of force people to be warm. I don't know if you can be forced to do that. But we know when we're arriving at or moving towards a community that's fueled with warmth, when people outside of an activity are reaching out to each other and connecting. So here, I've seen this, we've seen this in our church, we've seen this everywhere, every church we've ever been a part of. If we're talking specifically about young adults, people 19 to 29, when older people invite them to a meal,
yes,
that is warmth. That is huge. That is, whether it's inviting them to their home for a home cooked meal, or taking them out to dinner, or providing a meal, however that works, that communicates warmth. It communicates that you matter to us, and particularly. You know, obviously it's important for us as pastors to do that, and we do that and love doing it. It's absolutely wonderful. But to a certain extent, people know that's part of our job. And when a congregational member just does that because they want to do that, I mean, that's just huge. And so I see that, again, that sense of family and that warmth through older adults intentionally reaching out to those that are in their 20s, and one of the best ways to do that is to provide a meal and sit down and enjoy a meal with them.
Well, and of course, pandemic protocols have gotten in the way of
true,
all of that.
True.
But I still think that warmth can be conveyed in other yeah. ways. You could even do a meal drop to people. In fact, we have somebody we're doing a meal drop
right.
to this week.
Yeah.
We aren't. We've arranged a meal drop.
Right.
But. Yes, that kind of, I would also say that kind of warmth, as older adults reach out to younger adults, especially, and youth, that those are, we have some folks in our congregation who are good at that.
Yeah.
I see them doing it over and over again. Here's the thing, the rest of us can't use them as a crutch.
We need more.
We can't ask the same people to be doing that for everybody.
Yeah.
And so that our prayer would be that that just becomes, again, intrinsic to us. That it becomes just what we do, is we offer that to people. One thought, because I know our time's starting to wrap up, is that young adults and youth need to also see part of that warm community. It's not just nice, like Eric was said, it's doing life together, which means in the good times and the hard times. So for example, in the pandemic, being able to acknowledge that this is really hard and there's been enormous losses, and being able to leave space and grace for one another wherever we are in that journey, not putting a happy face on it, being able to say, and even in this, God is with us, and even in this, God is redeeming, and even in this, God is present. So that we, as older adults, are modeling what it means to acknowledge the fullness of our lives, the hard times and the good times. And we're making room then and modeling for young adults and for youth that they are safe with us if they need to talk about and bring their struggles here, that we don't belong as if it's a country club and we're bringing our dressed up selves.
Right.
We belong as we are. And then we help each other along the way. So wrapping up this piece of the warm relationship before we move into a couple of practices that we might look into and for us to talk about and discern, is using, again, another biblical theological model of the Trinity, and the mutuality of the relationship between God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Just real briefly, I grew up not realizing I was a heretic, that I was living out the heresy of thinking of the Trinity as a triangle with God the Father on top and God the Son down here and God the Holy Spirit. And that's a heresy called Arianism, and we can talk about it another time. But what I needed to do, and nobody ever told me, was flip that triangle flat or this way, so that there's no one on top, that there's a mutuality there. There's a mutuality within the Trinity in which each one plays its own valuable role, and they're all together as God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And so again, that same mutuality within our relationships in the church. And I see that mutuality. There's several Sunday school classes and several groups that I really see that mutuality. And again, part of the invitation to us, maybe a Lenten discipline, might be considering, how do we make that mutuality larger and encompass more people so that they understand that the warmth that and the mutuality and the deep love that exists within the Trinity is what it means to be the body of Christ, that it exists and works through us as well.
Let me build on that real quickly, and then we'll wrap up with a couple other points. Another youth ministry scholar, practitioner, person who was a little bit involved in Fuller, but he's not at Fuller, is a youth ministry professor named Andy Root. And he talks a lot about when we minister with each other, whether it's at a meal or it's talking about Jesus with someone who doesn't know him or walking alongside someone who's hurting or listening, that we actually encounter Jesus in that moment.
Absolutely, it's mutual.
That Jesus encounters us in the ministry activity. And so in the warmth of relational connection that is ministry within the church with each other, Jesus is present. And so we get Father, Son, and Holy Spirit working in that moment. So the Spirit helps us to bring the presence of Jesus in that encounter. And one way of thinking of it is that it's our joy and our privilege to attend to the presence of Jesus, that is to recognize the presence of Jesus. And we, in the church, with brothers and sisters, we do that with an awareness that hopefully everybody has within that encounter. But when we're ministering with people outside of the church, the other person or other people may not have an awareness of the presence of Jesus, and so we have the opportunity of helping them to see Jesus where he is. So again, the warmth is not just about being nice, it's a warmth that flows from the operations of the Trinity, so to speak, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit working together in and through us by the Spirit, and we're helping people to see Jesus and to experience the warmth that exists within the Trinity.
And we're also experiencing Jesus through them.
Yes.
I think that's really key.
Yes.
I do want to bring that up. Sort of one of the corporate models of church, which thanks be to God, the church is moving away from more back towards this biblical model of family and of the body of Christ, kind of looks at people as problems to be solved, or ministries, programs as means to an end,
right,
as opposed to ministry as places of learning and growth together. And so when we're talking about relationships between older people and young adults, and young adults and older people, the older people are not there to fix the young adults. We're here to walk alongside each other. And sometimes we will have wisdom to impart. Sometimes they'll have wisdom to impart to us. So it's about mutuality.
So we could go on forever with this, because we could kind of build on each other. Have you noticed that? We kind of trigger different thoughts in a beautiful way. You triggered one more thing. So I loved how you talked about, we tend to see people as problems to be solved, and instead of people to be loved. And even another way of saying this, to think of a student, a teenager, a young adult, not as a problem to be solved, but as a mystery to be entered into. Mystery in a positive way, because we're all mysteries. But every person that we encounter, we're not trying to fix them, we're honoring them by being attentive to them, and by listening to them, and trying to see where God is at work in their lives. And it's easy to think of our teenagers as mysteries, but we all are. And so the mystery is not so much a problem to be solved, but it's this wonderful work of God that is every person that we have the privilege of walking alongside and entering into a relationship with. So we could do this forever.
At the end of every chapter, you'll notice that they have some of maybe 10 or so ideas that they have seen working in these growing young churches that they're throwing out there for us to consider. And they're always careful to say, don't try to do all 10 or whatever, right, however number it is. Don't do that. Look and discern and prayerfully consider what it is that we're called to do. So I this is probably one of their last things they mentioned, but I want to mention it first, which is this: warmth is slow. It's slow growth.
Yeah.
It is investing in people. It is loving one another. It is slow growth. So it's not like, you know, as we all know, teenagers can sometimes be a bit of a challenge to interact with at first. There's some hostility, sometimes some standoffishness, some awkwardness, and that's all normal. But the more we earn trust and are consistent and loving, then the more that disappears, and we see them as the real people they are, and they see us as the real people we are. So it's slow growth, but it's worth it.
Good.
Oh, I thought you were raising your finger. They talk about that 5 adults to 1 young person is kind of a norm. Now, that doesn't mean that 5 people like team up in a necessarily focused way.
Oh, that's not a bad idea.
That's not a bad idea to have a care team.
Every, yeah.
We could do that, but I don't mean like they descend on this person. But that if a student or a young person has 5 people in the church that they have some sort of significant connection to, and those can be Sunday school teachers, it could be a small group leader, it could be a pastor, it could be just another adult in church that they think is cool, that they like. Maybe it's somebody that knew them when they were a little kid and has stayed in connection or chooses to reconnect. That's really essential to help them feel connected and to want to be a part and to belong. Again, there's that sense of belonging. If they're not finding it at church, they're going to be looking at other places. They do talk about making worship feel more like family and different ways to do that. I'm a huge fan, and I hope folks have been noticing in the past 6 months or so, we've really been trying, as the pandemic has shifted a little bit, we've been trying to include more people as we have been able to in worship leadership, and that includes all ages, and that's a real value.
And that's one of those byproducts of the pandemic, in that understandably and rightfully so, a higher percentage of our older members of the congregation have been very cautious, which we're glad.
Yeah.
But we have felt more comfortable asking teenagers to be here in person, and it's been great, and I think that will continue. I mean, I think we've learned that is something that we want to be a regular part of keychain leadership, but also we're just family. It's family. Mm-hmm.
Right, and when you're the family of God, you include everybody. Yeah, I've loved that.
Yeah.
I've loved seeing that, and loved seeing young people feel more, they become more confident the more that they're leading in worship, and they get that experience, and we get the experience of being led by them. And so again, there's this mutuality, this warmth. So they're being a more family feel. Now, one thing I was thinking about when I was thinking about the family feel is I love our sanctuary. When we first came and visited here, I fell in love with our sanctuary. I think it's gorgeous. I love being in that space. And I have noticed, as people have been able to come back at different times during this pandemic time, people will walk in and just say, oh, it feels so good to be back at church.
That's actually, so we've never left, obviously, the sanctuary, because we're here, even if we're just recording. But it's this really special moment for us when we happen to be there at the door when someone comes back to the sanctuary who hasn't been here. It's pretty neat.
And that's what we want for everybody, as much as possible, that they feel at home here. But
so when you come back for the first time, make sure we're around so that we can just kind of be there with you. You know what I mean?
And experience the moment.
Yeah.
But, so going back to our sanctuary, it is beautiful, and many of us have a long history in it, in which we have lots of memories, powerful memories of moments when we have experienced the presence of God in a powerful way, and the presence of one another, others in the body of Christ. But for some people, it is a big space, it's a big open space, the platform is pretty far from the pews, you know, different things like that. We may need to be thinking about some more intentional ways to make worship feel warmer for folks who are new or for young adults who might be used to worshiping in a different setting. That may just be something that those of us who have been here a long time or who love church architecture and our kind of worship space, which I just love, and all the stained glass, that's just something for us to be aware of, that's something we could be thinking about and praying about. Another one is, again, moving from that corporate America model for how to be the church to back to the biblical family and body of Christ model. And that with that, we embrace one another. And how do we reflect that in our worship? And how do we reflect that as we work with the youth? How do we reflect that at intergenerational events like the picnic? How do we reflect that in our intergenerational prayer ministries like Heart to Heart, which involves older women and younger women, and Pray for Me, and Adopt a College Student? You know, beyond just sending a card, what does it mean to really begin to form a relationship with somebody that we are family, and showing them we're family? One option they mentioned that I got really excited about was short-term intergenerational small groups. That would center around maybe a project or a biblical book or a shared interest.
Right.
And then again, they'd be short term. You're not talking about 6 months, you're talking about 6 weeks maybe of doing life together and getting to know one another.
And we're doing a little bit of that now with the Sunday school class, Bible study in the fellowship hall.
That's intergenerational.
It's intergenerational. You don't have to be a part of any particular Sunday school class. Anybody is invited to come. And you know, we'll do that for a while, it's a good experiment. Is there one other thing on your list that you want to cover before we wrap up?
Yes, mine would be about praying warmly. I loved that part. That when we pray for one another, and not just pray for one another generally, but specifically, and follow up, which is what Pray for Me and Heart to Heart are all about. But how else can we incorporate that so that our youth and young adults are being, and all of us, are being intentionally prayed for by one another, and not just on our own, but then we follow up. Well, you know, how is that going? Or where did you see God in this? Or to say, when I was praying for you, this thought came up for me. Or to even just, when somebody comes in your mind, text them, call them, email, whatever, or the next time you see them, say, you've been on my mind this week. That when we are consistently warmly praying for one another, we are being the body of Christ, and we are showing the love of family, which is what we're called to do. So this warmth, as you can tell, it lit me up. This chapter really lit me up. This is my bailiwick. This is what I have deep, deep passion about. Personally, I would have loved if they'd started with this, because I think, to me, you know, they talked about this being core,
right.
Just the way my brain works, I'm sure there's a reason they did it the way they did it, and I trust their wisdom and judgment. But this, for me, is really foundational, and it's a place that I think we already have some really good things to build on, but we have a lot of room to grow and flourish as well.
Amen. Amen. Let's pray together as we wrap up our time. Lord, we're grateful for the challenge from the authors of this study to examine the ways in which we reflect the warmth of Jesus or do not reflect the warmth of Jesus through the Spirit to each other in our church and to our young people and to our neighbors. We pray that you would fuel a warm community among us, build on the warmth that is already here, expand it, enable it to grow, that people of all ages would grow together toward you in the warmth of your love. It is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, everyone.